cloud-native architecture has evolved from the issues and difficulties seen with legacy approaches. In the past, it was very common to see applications poorly designed and poorly utilized. Cloud-native architecture has brought us what could be considered much-needed wisdom on how to effectively design applications and infrastructure. The design patterns and practices created through years of mistakes and evolution provide us with a selection of best practices that focus on application availability, cost management, efficiency, and reliability. There's a great overview here on the CNCF Charter, which you can pause and read if you like, but I bring your attention to this bit. These techniques enable loosely coupled systems that are resilient, manageable, and observable. Combined with robust automation, they allow engineers to make high-impact changes frequently and predictably with minimal toil. Let's explore a use case that compares a traditional monolithic application to that of an application leveraging the principles of cloud-native architecture. Monolithic applications are typically tightly coupled, making them difficult to deploy and manage. When an application is tightly coupled, a change to one area can potentially affect the entire application. Let's break this down further to understand the issues we face with these types of approaches. The user interface in this example could be a web server hosted on the likes of Apache or Nginx, and often in a legacy monolithic setup and configuration. This would have been installed and configured through a conventional Linux mechanism into the operating system that is running. For example, using apt or yum to install the software on top of the Linux operating system. Both apt and yum are exceptional package management systems, and the problem is not with them, more so the monolithic approach of installing each required component directly onto the Linux operating system. When this is done outside a container or a microservices approach, it would typically result in the application being distributed on the same file system as the operating system and will ultimately share system resources, libraries, and other applications that are running on that system. The more applications that you add, the bigger this problem becomes. What then happens if, for example, application 2 and application 3 are dependent on the same library? And then at a later stage, application 3 requires a newer version of that library. Changing the library may, for example, affect the other application. Looking at the next layer that we actually have here, the business logic. This may have been written or hosted in a language such as PHP or Java, which are completely fine, but typically, this may have been configured and integrated directly within the running web server, i.e. your Apache or your Nginx. Why is this bad? Well, now we have what could be considered tight coupling between those entities. It's now more difficult to work on either of these without actually affecting the other. Remember, one of the key guidelines for a cloud-native application is that we can make high-impact changes frequently and predictably with minimal toil. The next layer that we actually have here, the data interface. In monolithic applications, often databases were used to provide connectivity between the business logic and the database. There may be specific configuration on the host in question. So, for example, there may be a need to have ODBC drivers. We know where this is going. It's more tight coupling, this time between the business logic and the data interface. We've essentially got an entire architecture that is quite fragile and at risk of changes. And we really can't be as dynamic as we desire with such an approach. The same application could also be considered from a cloud-native viewpoint. Microservices, for example, allow each of these components to be broken down into smaller units that ease installation, management, maintenance, and deployability. As a microservice, the installation and configuration could be encapsulated into standalone units, therefore functioning as dedicated components that serve specific roles. So, for example, serving the application's user interface and front-end access. With this, we could technically mix the services being used. We could, for example, have different microservices serving different parts of the front-end experience. So through ingress routing, the main web page might be using this microservice, whereas another URL/store is served by a completely different microservice. Each microservice also typically has its own networking and connectivity, therefore eliminating cross-contamination of port usage, where services use common ports. So here you can actually see Apache and Nginx independently running on 443, what is the HTTPS secure port. Should there be a requirement to perform maintenance or update, it will be much easier and convenient for the individuals that specialize in these areas to take action independently of other teams. The data layer you can see at the bottom is an interesting viewpoint from a microservices layer and therefore will vary significantly depending on the needs and the use of the application in question. By the way, with microservices, there's also a lot of flexibility. We could, for example, have a microservice talking to another microservice and then to a data store. In some designs where a database is implicitly required, a microservice may be a database that functions on a one-to-one ratio. In other scenarios, this may involve database services that use replication and sharding with other database microservices for high availability. Alternatively, there's distributed key-value stores like etcd, commonly used as the store of truth in Kubernetes. Regardless of the overall end result, you can see from this design that we now have a lot of flexibility. This design becomes a lot easier to manage, maintain, and upgrade. We could easily swap out entire components, which is vastly different from what we see with a monolithic application. We'll continue our research into cloud-native architecture by looking specifically at cloud-native practices that we can adopt as part of our cloud-native architectural design.